one through month 60, shift, amortize, whoops. Equal to get our balance at the end of month 60. And so you should end up with a balance of 96,574.32, and that would be your balloon payment at the end of year five. Does that make sense, everybody? Okay. Any questions on that? All right, moving forward. Okay, what if we had a interest-only mortgage or zero amortizing mortgage? An interest-only mortgage, also called zero amortizing. Okay, most common name is interest-only. But what this is, this is what I was describing last week. This is kind of, if you will, sort of the beginning of mortgage loans, where you simply are making an interest-only payment either each month or each year, whatever it is. You're not actually paying down any of the principal. So the way that it would work, $100,000 is what you borrowed, and if you have a 10% interest rate, you're simply going to be multiplying. You're simply going to be multiplying $100,000 times 10%, and that means that you would have $10,000 in interest expense for the year. And because there is no principal repaid, you can simply take that interest expense per year and multiply it, or sorry, divide it by 12 to get the monthly interest expense. And you would get a monthly interest expense of $833.33. Well, now you should recognize, and I did this on purpose, that number was what? That was our first month's interest expense. But with the interest only, that number never changes. That's the only payment that you have. You have $833.33 every single month for as long as you have the loan. But the reality is, you can have this loan for a million years. You're never going to pay it off because it is an interest only loan. You are not paying down any of the principal on the loan for as long as you own it. Does that make sense, everybody? Okay. And a lot of construction loans can be set up to where they're interest only as well, and you don't actually pay off the balance until you basically take out your permanent mortgage at the end, and then you pay in one big lump sum the actual construction loan. But once again, those are all different as well. We'll get into those later. Okay. Now, does everybody understand mechanically what's going on here? Yes or no? Okay, now, let's just say that I were to tell you something like, all right, you've got a interest-only loan with a $1,500 a month payment with a 7% interest rate. Tell me, what is my loan amount? Okay, this, and the reason I'm saying it this way, it's a logic question, okay? It's not really that complicated, but you, if you understand the logic, you'll get it right. Okay, if you don't understand the logic, it just tells me you don't understand it, okay? So what are you gonna do? Basically, reverse engineer this, okay? You're gonna take the 1500 and do what? Multiply it by 12 to get the annual, and then divide by the interest rate of 0.07, and that would give you the loan amount. So let's just do that real quick. So 1500 times 12 would be 18,000. So, oops, 180, 18,000. So 18,000 would be your annual interest expense, okay? Then you would take that, divide that by 0.07. So your loan amount on this would be 254,142.85.86. Okay? Now, and just to check yourself, what could you do? Work it back the other direction. You know, start with this, multiply it by the interest rate of the 0.07, you get, in this case, the 18,000, divide that by 12, and then you should get the 1,500. Okay? So it's a whole idea. I'm sorry?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, what up?
254.
Okay. You take the 254,142 multiplied by 0.07, which would give you the 18,000. Then you would take that, divide it by the 12 to get the 1,500. If you're working it backwards. Oh, I'm sorry. My eyesight is just really getting bad. Okay. Okay, 257. All right, now, everybody cool with that? Yes, no, possibly could be. Okay, moving forward. All right. Let's talk about a nasty little thing called negative amortization. Okay. Negative amortization is where you end up owing more money than you did owe. Okay? And this can happen for, you know, several different reasons, but in essence, it could be a situation of where you've renegotiated the terms of your loan in some way, but maybe let's just work through an example and kind of explain it as we go along. And you'll sort of see what I'm talking about. All right, so once again, during our same old loan over and over again, $100,000, present value, 10%, 30 years, solve for the payment, get our $877.57. Okay. Now, what if this was our loan, and we made this loan with our lender, but we've fallen on hard times, okay? We lost our job, or in the case of the, on, you know, the commercial side of the business, we've lost some of our major tenants in our property. So we are no longer able to afford the $877.57 for whatever reasons, okay? And our lender has graciously allowed us to lower our monthly mortgage payment to $500 a month, okay? Now, you say, why would the lender potentially do that? Well, the lender maybe doesn't want to have to foreclose on the property, and the lender wants some cash flow is better than no cash flow. And so, but the lender is also not so forgiving with respect to just allowing you to make that lower payment and there not to be penalties affiliated with it, okay? So if you think about what is going to happen here is if the payment that is necessary to amortize the loan fully is $877.57, and you're only paying in $500 a month, all of that money, first of all, is going toward interest. None of it's going to be going toward principal. But what's going to happen is your balance on your loan is going to start increasing because you are basically deferring, if you will, some of your interest expense because you're not paying it each month. Does that make sense? Yes or no? Okay, so all you do, the scenario, here are the loan terms, the lender has allowed you now to reduce your payment to $500 a month. What are the implications? All right, so let's just say that this were to happen immediately, okay? We're to keep the example simple. It happens the moment you get the loan, all right? If that's the case, and we want to look and see what happens to our balance after 60 months, okay, let's see what happens. Most concerned with is the ending balance. So instead of owing, I mean, keep in mind, we start out with a $100,000 loan. So by basically making that smaller payment of 500 bucks, we now owe an extra 25 grand. Okay? Does that make sense? Yes or no? Now, chances are the lender's not going to allow you to defer it for that long a period of time. Usually it's the sort of thing, okay, this is a short-term hiccup, we're having difficulty getting a new tenant, you know, it's going to take us, you know, because, you know, Dustin has done a lousy job of getting us a new tenant, you know, and so, you know, hopefully he's able to pick up the pace and get us that new tenant within short order, therefore we can start paying our normal payment again and hopefully get caught up on all the payments in arrears. Okay, make sense? Okay, any questions? Okay. All right. Moving on. Okay. Concept of sort of lender's yield. Also, from our perspective, effective cost of borrowing. Okay, from the lender's perspective, it's their yield. From the borrower's perspective, it's the effective cost of borrowing. Same thing, it's just, once again, two different perspectives, okay? So, usually, a lender will go into a loan situation and they will know what they want to yield on that loan in terms of an overall rate of return that they want to extract from the borrower, okay? The parallel to this is if you have an investor, an equity investor, typically they have what? A hurdle rate or some sort of a rate of return that they want to achieve as an investor, yes? Well, a lender's very similar to a certain extent. They want to know they can achieve some sort of a rate of return, okay? And one way for them to get to that rate of return is to charge you those extra fees of the loan origination fees, prepayment penalties, and the administrative cost over the course of the loan to maybe move what might have been a 5% loan to give them a yield of 6% or 7%. Does that make sense? Okay, so they may want to kind of back solve things to kind of help them to get there. So as an example, once again, typical problem you're going to be sick of if you're not already, $100,000, 10%, 30 years, payment of $877.57. Now, in this case, the problem as stated, what is the lender's yield? 10%. What is your effective cost of borrowing? 10%. Okay, because we haven't added on anything yet. Okay, now, in this particular case, let's say that the lender wants to yield 12%. So, lender desires 12% lender's yield. Okay? So how can we accomplish that for them if we know what we have to work with in terms of the loan origination fees, prepayment penalties, and the administrative cost? All right? So let's just say we're going to take one of those. For example, the loan origination fees. Okay? So what could we do? We could just simply pop in right here, 12% is the yield they want, and then solve for present value. Well, and we'll talk to the logic on this. Okay, do all of this. Okay, and we end up with $85,316.04. Okay, what does that number represent? That represents the net dispersal that the lender would be able to make. That's not the amount that they would be able to charge in the loan origination fees. That would be taking the $100,000, subtracting out the $85,316.04, meaning $14,683.96 would be the loan origination fees that they would have to charge in order to achieve that 12% rate of return over the entire 30-year mortgage. Make sense? Yes or no? Okay, so we're just sort of kind of flipping things around a little bit. All right? But let's not make it so easy. Okay, instead, let's say this is only going to be done over a couple of years. Okay, and so let's say that in this particular case, we're going to do it over a 2-year period, and we want to see what the fees would be. Okay, so I'm just going to scratch out these two lines as if they never existed. We're going to re-put in this information, and then we're going to solve for what is the balance at the end of the first 2 years. Balance was $98,830.04. Okay? Now, I'm repositioning the question a little bit. So what I'm saying now is, all right, the lender still wants a 12% yield, but the borrower is going to pay off the loan at the end of 24 months instead of carrying it out for the full 30 years. So how much would we have to charge in these loan origination fees in order to accommodate that? Okay, this makes it a little bit more complex, a little bit more interesting. Okay, so what you're going to do, okay, this is where our timeline's going to come into play.
One second, the 98 did you use for 12%? Would we have that 98?
No. That's why I said if you scratch out these two pieces and just start after.
This 15.
Right.
Long.
Okay. So we did that. And so here's what it looks like on our timeline, just to sort of make sure that it's sort of clear. Okay. At time period zero, this is from the, let's say, the borrower's perspective. Okay. What is happening at time period zero? Well, initially, they are going to get their $100,000, and then they are going to be making payments of the negative $877.57 from month number one through, in this case, originally, $360. Okay? But that's not the case anymore. Now it's only going to be through month 24. Okay? And at the end of month 24, they're going to have to pay off the balance of the negative $98,830.04. Okay? What we want to know, and that's at the 10% interest rate. Okay? So that's the setup, if you will, to start us. Everybody follow the logic there. Okay, so now what we're saying is the lender is not going to be satisfied with the 10%, they want 12%. So we're basically scratching out that 10% and we're going to be substituting it with 12%. But what is it we're going to be changing? Are we going to be changing the balance? No. Are we going to be changing the payment? No. We're going to be having to change the loan amount. Okay, so what we're going to be doing is we're going to be solving for basically what is the new present value or what is the dollar amount that's going to be charged to the borrower up front given those set of circumstances. Does that make sense? So in other words, here's what's happening to simplify it. Again, all of this stays the same. Okay. So we had all of this. So now what we're basically saying is, all right, we want, after we have done all of this, we want to change the following. We want to make the term 24 months, so 24 in. We want to change and add in a future value of $98,830.04 as a future value. And then what we are going to do is put in 12% as our new interest rate. And then what that's going to allow us to solve for is what is our new overall present value or loan amount. Once we have this number, then we're going to take that and we're going to subtract it from the original 100,000, and then that is going to give us the amount of the loan fees that the lender would have to charge up front in order to achieve that particular rate of return. Okay? So, let's see what we've got here. And so I get, in this case, $96,477.78. Okay, do you match with that?
Yeah.
Okay, so now what you do is you take and you subtract that. Okay, from the 100,000. So that means in order to achieve that 12% rate of return, they would have to charge $3,522 in loan fees. Well, now, the thing you should notice here, you were paying attention earlier, if the loan were they were having to amortize these over the entire 30 years, they had to charge this amount to get that 12%. But because the person's going to pay off after 2 years, they really don't have to charge them that much up front in order to achieve that 12% rate of return for 2 years. Okay? Make sense?
When you said loan fees or
origination? Same thing. For our purposes.
Okay.
Loan origination fees up front.
So I didn't get the 98.
Okay.
I didn't see what it did to get the 98.
Okay. So the 98, 830 was just simply putting in the normal loan information, skipping over these two steps here, and then starting with one input 24 to get the balance at the end of that 2 year period, or 24 months. Okay? More quick concepts before we take the first quiz. All right.
So that last one, are we taking into account any sort of prepayment penalty or anything? Or
not with this one, no.
Okay.
Nope, not with this one. Okay. Okay. So the next one that we're going to deal with, we've already dealt with loan origination fees, discount points, we've dealt with loan fees and early repayment. So now we're down to the constant amortizing mortgage. Okay. All right, now if you remember from our discussions last week, what is the constant amortizing mortgage? It is where you are paying off an equal amount of principal, not interest and principal, but an equal amount of principal each period or each month. So as an example, if we have our $100,000 loan and it is for 30 years or 360 months, that means each month we would be paying off $277.78 in principal. Does that make sense, conceptually? Okay? It's probably one of the easiest kinds of loans to calculate because you don't even have to use a financial calculator to come up with the payments. All you're really having to do is to simply use your brain and think, okay, I have $100,000 I need to pay off over 360 months or 30 years with monthly payments. So that just simply means each month my balance on the loan is going to reduce by $277.78. Okay? Now these loans aren't as prevalent as what they used to be. They still exist though. Okay? And one of the advantages is that you just simply know, I mean, from a simplicity point of view, how much your balance is reducing, you know, each month, and you can do the calculations pretty simply. Just know that each month you're going to reduce your balance by $277.78. Okay? All right. Now, what I might ask is, well, first of all, what is your mortgage payment for this loan? Well, that depends on what your interest rate is. Well, if our interest rate is 10%, we've already established that the interest expense, at least for that first month for the $100,000, would be $833.33. Okay? That would be interest. Everybody with me? Yes, no, possibly could be. Alright? Now, so our first month's payment for a constant amortization mortgage would be taking our interest payment and adding it to our principal payment. Okay, so month one, if you will, is going to be 833.33 plus 277.78, which is going to be 1,111.11. Does that make sense? So that would be our month one payment. Now, this will tell me whether or not you understand the concept or not based upon your answer to this simple question. Is my payment for month two going to be the same? Is it going to be less? Or is it going to be more than the 11-11-11? Same, less, or more? Which one?
Less.
Okay. The reason why it's going to be less is because we have paid off $277.78 of principal in that first month. So therefore, our next month's interest amount is going to be less. Our principal is going to stay the same, but our interest is going to be less. Now, here's the beauty of this loan is it will amortize quicker. Okay? In other words, your payments will be more up front than what they will be with the normal mortgage, but it will amortize quicker, and you'll pay down more of the balance quicker than you will with the constant payment mortgage. Now, what you can do is you can sort of put them side by side and make comparisons of, well, which one was really better for you, you know, but anyway, okay. Now, for month two, we said that our principal is going to stay constant. So even if we went on to month three, still going to stay constant, okay, for the principal piece. Again, principal, interest. Now, for month two, once again, it's just about the logic to get there. For month two, we're going to take that $100,000, we're going to subtract out the $277.78 of principal, and that's going to give us a new balance for that loan. Of 99,722.22, okay, is going to be our balance at beginning of month two. Okay, now why is that important? Because that balance is what we're then going to have to calculate our interest expense off of for month two. Is everybody with me? So here, you're going to do the same thing we sort of did before, multiply it by 10%, divided by 12, okay? And you should end up with 831. Yeah, 02. Okay, does that make sense? Okay, so then you're going to take that amount, add it to your principal, and you end up with the new payment for month two of 1108.79.80. Okay? And you sort of follow that process over and over and over and over again. So obviously for this one, you can do it without doing a spreadsheet, but you've got to understand the, once again, the kind of the logic. Because, like, for example, if I wanted to find out, you know, what the balance was at the end of 5 years, how would I do that? Once again, use your brain for a second. How would you do that? Everybody can answer this except for Jordan and Dustin. Okay, what would be the loan balance of a constant amortization mortgage at the end of month 60? How would you get there? No, but shortcutting it without having to do everything, you know, do it for 60 consecutive months. How would we get there? Shorthand. Okay. You, the second part of what you said is correct. What, repeat that one more time.
277 times 60.
Yep. 277.78 times 60. That is going to tell us how much we have reduced the balance by over the first 60 months or 60 payments. Does that make sense, everybody? So basically 277.78 times 60 would be 16,666.80, and then we would simply take the 100,000 original balance, subtract out 16,666.80, and then that would be our balance at end of month 60. See what I'm saying about the logic?
Yeah.
Okay. Once you understand the logic, it's all very straightforward. But if you don't understand the logic, you're going to be clueless, okay? All right? Okay, so we end up with 83,333.20 as that balance at the end of month 6. Okay? Good? Okay, lock and roll. Okay. One more little topic and then we have our little quiz. Okay? How to take advantage of old people. Okay? Reverse annuity mortgages. How many times have you seen these on TV or heard on the radio or elsewhere? Okay? So what is a reverse annuity mortgage? Okay? Real simply put. You're an old person. You own your house free and clear. You have no debt, okay? You have a meager amount maybe coming in off of Social Security. Your house is worth $500,000. And you're saying to yourself, all right, I'd like some extra coin to be able to go do something fun or just to be able to live, okay? However you want to sort of phrase it. What can you do? Well, if you were to get a reverse annuity mortgage, what it allows you to do is, in essence, borrow against your home. Not like a home equity loan. Home equity loan is different. Home equity loan is a loan that you borrow against your home and then you have to repay. A reverse annuity mortgage is one where you're borrowing against your home and you're going to lose your home, theoretically, at the end of the reverse annuity sort of loan. And so you sort of say, okay, you know, I'm 75 years old, I'm going to live for 10 more years, so I want to get a reverse annuity mortgage that's going to make me annual payments for the next 10 years of my life, and at the end of that 10 years, I'm gone, so the house is gone and given away to the lender. Okay, that makes sense? All right. Now, and I'm not in any way, shape, form, or fashion advocating these, okay? Matter of fact, in many cases, quite the opposite, okay? Because to my standpoint, that's why I said, it's basically lenders taking advantage of old people, which is not a good thing to do. Okay, so the way that these are a little bit different, however, is that we are going to make the assumption that these payments are going to be made at the beginning of the year or beginning of the month. Therefore, we need to use the begin-end function on the calculator, okay? And I believe we briefly discussed that in our last class session, which is that in the event that we are going to be making or receiving payments at the beginning of the period or beginning of the month, we use the begin-end function, all right? And so in this particular case, we're going to do annual payments. All right, and we're going to say this is a $500,000 home. And so we're going to have $500,000, and the interest rate that we're going to use is, let's say, 5% for 5 years. Okay? And we are going to be looking for, in essence, the payment. Now, you notice I did something. I didn't put anything next to the $500,000. Okay? Because is this going to be present value? Or is it going to be future value?
Future value.
Future value. Now, here's where I want you to think of the logic. What we're basically saying is that the lender has said, your home right now is worth 500 grand. And so what I'm going to allow you to do is I'm going to allow you to build up a balance against that 500,000 over the next 5 years. Okay? Meaning, at the end of 5 years, you will either have to write the lender a check for 500,000 or you will forfeit the house. Does that make sense, everybody? Yes or no? Okay? That's the reason why we're using the 500,000. You can almost look at it as it's kind of like a line of credit against the house as well. Okay? Now, in this case, if we want to gain perspective here, that from the borrower's perspective, over five years, they're going to be receiving payments of a set dollar amount. They're going to receive their first payment here, second payment there, third payment, fourth payment, fifth payment, at the beginning of the period, not at the end. Okay? And then at the end, they've either got to pay off the $500,000 or, as we said, forfeit the house. So we could put the $500,000 as a negative if we wanted to be, once again, kind of consistent with the whole inflow, outflow sort of thing, okay? So we could put the $500,000 as a negative. Okay, we've got our 5% interest rate, 5-year term, so let's just see what the payment is. Value 5%. Return and then solve for the payment. $86,178.47.48, and that would be the dollar amount that they would receive at the beginning of the year for each of the 5 years. Now, it's still on an annual basis, not on a monthly basis. Annual basis. Once again, thus, now, if you're also, like, getting a slightly different number, it's because you didn't put the begin-end function on there. Okay? So, okay, we multiply this by 5 just to sort of see what the total dollar amount that they would be receiving is. So, the annual payment is $86,000 that they would be making. But for that $500,000 house, they're actually only getting cash, hard cash money of $430,000 over that period of time. And the reason for that is because the lender is extracting that 5% interest, obviously, over that time period for the buildup over the 5-year term. Okay, now, once again, if you're not getting this amount, it's because you did not put in, once again, begin in function. Now, after you have finished with this problem, make sure that you hit the shift begin end function. Otherwise, it will keep you in that mode and it will screw you up on other problems. So if you have the word begin in your display right now after you've completed this, to get rid of that, hit the shift and then the begin end and it will remove it from your display. Okay? Everybody comfortable with that? Yes, no, possibly could be. All right, I think Let's do another quick read of the first quiz here. Should be able to do all 10 questions. All right, get this baby started. Quiz two.
Yeah, 10%. It's basically what it's meaning this.
Just so there's no confusion, the first nine questions are all 12 payments per year. Only question number 10 is one payment per year. guys need to be wrapping this thing up pretty quickly. Okay, 2 more minutes, and then turn everything in. Okay, we need to turn these things in, let's go. Pieces of paper.
This is going to be a whole lot of time to prepare.
No, I already did it.
When are you going to do that 1B?
Yeah, the one that you have got, Albert.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what you
have. What's the last
name? Maya.
Maya.
Here's my, here's my vice president. He's the main guy. Yeah, yeah. Oh, you got to talk. You got to talk to me. That's good sign. Definitely.
There you go.
He's the main guy. He's got the main guy. So, yeah, go up to the leader.
So, do I think we need to stay up all night?
All right, you got all of them? My last call. Mortgages pretty much in the 1970s was primarily to deal with an ever-changing sort of interest rate environment where we the very volatile interest rates, increasing interest rates, and so it was meant as a tool by lenders to try to mitigate some of their interest rate risk. And so what they were doing is selling products that in essence would, in many cases, give a borrower a lower interest rate, but only for a relatively short time horizon before that interest rate would adjust to some sort of new higher level. Well, they also would create, in some instances from a marketing perspective, these adjustable rate mortgage, what were initially referred to as teaser rates. Now, teaser rates are, in essence, it's kind of like that whole thing of how a retailer gets you into the store by offering you some sort of a special deal on some sort of product, and then once you're in there, then hopefully you're going to not only buy that product, but buy other products. Well, to a certain extent, the lender's approach to this is very similar. They're wanting to get you in the door to make this loan with them. So what they're going to do is, in many cases, offer you a very low introductory teaser rate, usually for a relatively short time horizon. And to some extent, this can be very predatory on the part of the lenders, because it's like they tell you, all right, come in, we're going to give you this introductory rate of 2% on your mortgage, all right? But then after 6 months, after a year, some other, you know, sort of set period, then that rate adjusts to some sort of a market rate, and that market rate might be 7 or 8%. Okay? So you got this sweetheart deal coming in at 2%, and your payments are based on it being at 2%, but then all of a sudden it jumps up to something much more substantial at a later time period. Does that make sense, everybody, conceptually? Well, the whole idea behind that teaser rate is, like I said, kind of get you in the door. Now, the way that this would work So let's say that the intro rate, teaser rate, is 2% for year one, and then it jumps to 10% thereafter. Okay, keep things roughly simple. And we're going to use our same old problem. 12 payments per year, $100,000 loan for 30 years. But now, instead of 10% interest rate, we're going to use the 2% teaser rate. So our monthly payment, instead of $877.57, is going to be $369. Big difference. $369.62 is going to be our monthly payment. What's a big difference than what we've been getting at a 10% interest rate, which was $877.57, yes? Okay, now think about mortgages, and think about what the lender is qualifying you for with respect to that mortgage. If you're an individual and you're buying a house, typically the mortgage is, you know, obviously based on the house, but in terms of how large of a mortgage they're willing to give you as an individual, it's based upon what? Your income. Okay? Well, the income that you need to qualify for a $369 mortgage is obviously a whole lot less than the income that you would need to qualify for an $877.57 a month payment, correct? You sort of follow what I'm saying? Yes or no? Okay, in other words, when you go to the car dealership to get a car, one of the first questions they will ask you is, how much of a monthly payment can you afford? Okay, because they're trying to then work backwards from that to determine how expensive of a vehicle are you willing or able to potentially take on. Same thing is true with the mortgage, in the sense that we pretty much know if this is what you can afford, then we can pretty much back figure how expensive of a mortgage that you could get, okay? Well, but with this low interest rate, it's kind of deceptive, because the reality is, yeah, you can afford a $100,000 mortgage if your interest rate is 2%, but if that interest rate were 10%, we already know from all the calculations we have done over and over again that that monthly payment is going to be $877.57. All right, well, if we subtract out the difference between the two, it's a difference of $507.95. That's a big difference, okay? The person that can afford a $369 mortgage is probably not gonna be the same person that's gonna afford an $877 mortgage. Do you follow what I'm saying? Okay, my point is they're able to lure people in with this really ridiculously low intro rate. And you're saying, well, wait a second, why would a lender do this knowing that they're going to raise the rate and then the person's not going to be able to pay? I mean, think about that logic for a second. Because this is exactly what happened in 2006, 2007. You know, this is part of why we have part of the problem that we have, okay, is because these loans were being made with these sort of intro rates. But see, here was what was going on. You were making these loans as the lender to these folks at the 2% rate, and then within a few months after you have made the loan, you're selling off the loans to Enrique here, and what's gonna happen is all of them are gonna start blowing up after a year because the people aren't gonna be able to afford this new payment. Does that make sense? But the thing is, he may not be able to hold you directly responsible for it because he should have read the documentation and understood that that was going to happen. Does that make sense? Yes? No? Yeah. Possibly could be? Okay. All right. Moving forward. Now, all right. So if this is the case, that once again, that 369.62 is going to be the rate for the first year,